Folks, it is no surprise that LangChain comes out with some of the best tools out there for large language model apps. And this time, they have released LangSmith. It's your one-stop shop for testing, evaluating, logging, and tracing large language model apps in production. In this video, we're going to look at 7 ways how you can benefit from using LangSmith in your production LLM application. And we're going to look at how we can set up LangSmith for code-based and no-code-based tools. So let's get started. First is you can see all of your project, and within your projects, you can see your runs. You can pretty much see what were the inputs, outputs, and also latency, token usage, and a bunch of other information. This high-level overview can really help you understand how your users are using the chat interface, and also it will give you a good understanding as what your chat application is doing at different steps. So in this case, I can see that it's calling the LLM, using tool, and then also calling LLM again after that. Now, second is I can go into each of these runs and actually see in details how the chat app worked. So I can see here that the agent executor worked in this case, and it had the input provided. Then it gave some output from there. I can go into each step as what happened, what was the system message, what was the human message provided, and what was the response from the AI. I can also see that there was a tool used in this case, and there was an input for the tool by the agent app, and then there was an output provided using that tool. Third is I can actually see what the agent application or any large language model app is doing. We can see exactly what were the steps taken. So this can really help. Now, if you were to go back and make changes, you can play with the system message. You can perhaps ask for it to include a thought process, and you can see everything that happened stepwise. And if there are many different steps involved, you can see all of those steps and the action taken by your chat application. Fourth is you can see the token usage and latency for this application. This can be very helpful if you have many different users, and if you'd like to optimize your token usage, this can be very helpful. You can also go back to your main dashboard and see every run as how long it took and how many tokens it used. So if you were to optimize, then you can target the ones that use a lot of resources or tokens and optimize how your chat application is working for those particular cases. Fifth is something that I found really cool is that you can add tags to your application. So for example, if I have a code-based application and I have some options for users to play around with, in this case, I have about 7 lessons here. And then if we have different type of lessons, so we have different prompts in this case, now I can look in the logs that what type of option was selected by the user. So in that case, you'll see at a high level, what are the most used features or options. And in case if you would like to optimize or debug, then you can go to that particular option or tag and then make changes to that option. Now, for folks using no-code-based tools, LangFlow or Flowise, it will by default take the tags available by those platforms. So if I were to use OpenAI function as an agent, it pulls that, or OpenAI multifunctions in this case. So if I were to use any of the agent application, I see by default it pulls those tags. So as of now, that is not an option available for no-code tools, but in future, most likely, this will be something that you can configure. Sixth is another cool feature, which is to get feedback. And this is something that you can add in your chat application. Now, this is available for the code-based solution, where it will show as a feedback option once the chat is completed. So in here, I see there's a thumbs up, thumbs down, and once a user provides feedback, that is available to us in our dashboard, where you'll see a factor. Either it's going to be 1 or 0. So if you have a lot of thumbs down, then certainly you can go there and change how the app is running in that particular case. And last but not least, if you are looking to share any of these runs, you can easily share that and make changes accordingly. You can also rate your runs in the dashboard so that you have some sort of internal metric of how you rate any of these responses. Now, this is just starting with the LangSmith tool. In a future video, we'll also look at how dataset and testing could be done using LangSmith. First thing, once you make an account, you will have access to this dashboard. You'll see your projects and datasets. So my suggestion is to start with a new project. You can give any name as you like, and once you hit submit, you will be brought to this screen. If you are using code-based LangChain, the assumption is that you have already installed LangChain. And what you're going to do is you will take all of these environment variables and copy in your project. So I'm going to copy this. And in a LangChain project that I'm working on, I can create a new file and I can call this .env. And in here, I can paste those values. Now, the thing that we have to change is we have to provide an API key. And the way you can do that is back in the LangSmith dashboard, we can create a new API key and we can just copy this key over. Again, this is something that you want to keep it secret. I will delete this after this video. So once this is copied, we can bring it over and then we can provide it in this application. Now, you might have some other environment variables. You might have your OpenAI API key or any of the provider you're using. You can add those to this file as well. And one thing that you'll have to remember is to remove all of these exports. So I'm going to copy all of these and then remove that. And now you can save this environment file and pretty much run your application. Once you run your application, you will see logs of that in your project. So I created a few different projects before, and this is what I will see on the project dashboard. Now for the no-code audience, we're going to look at how we can use LangSmith with Flowise and LangFlow. And in Flowise, we previously showed how one can run Flowise on render.com. So the first step is that you will go to the Flowise repo and you will fork that repo. And once you do that, so I have that available in my account. Once you do that, you will see that it will be under your account. And if you had already forked it before, it's advisable to synchronize the fork so you can update that branch. And once it is synced, it will be up to date. And then you can head over to render.com and create a new web service. And with that, you can connect with the recently synchronized repo. And once you do that, it will bring you to a dashboard where you can name the service. So I have named this Flowise LangSmith, and I am just changing the runtime to Node since this is something we have shown previously on the channel. Then you can add these commands. These commands are available on the Flowise repo, where if you were to look at the installation steps, it mentions that you have to do yarn install, build, and start. And that's exactly what we did over here. Then you have to select an instance type. We have mentioned this before, where the free version causes issues with saving the flows. So it's always advisable to use one of the paid versions. And then the advanced section, we are going to add variables. Now for the environment variables, we will go back to our LangSmith dashboard. And in here, the same place where we had setup and the environment variables, we can copy all of these and bring it over. And either we can add one by one as environment variables, or we can add a secret file. I'm going to call this .env and then paste all of the content. And since we're creating an .env file, we are going to remove all of these exports. Now these are our environment variables. So I'm going to do the same thing. I'll bring over the newly created API key. Now that should take care of adding the environment variables. Now we can save this and proceed. Now, we have also shown before how we can add the authentication. So if you were to look at the render-based documentation available on Flowise, you'll see that one could also add a username and password. This will make sure that only you have access to the dashboard for Flowise. And other thing is that if you would like to add a persistent disk, Then you can follow steps where you mount a path, and this is available in the render dashboard, where you can go to the disk section and in here add a disk and then provide a mount path and a name. And this mount path is going to be exactly as available here on the documentation. And once you provide that, you will save it, and then you will head back to the environment variables and add these additional environment variables to make sure that your Flowise application knows where the database is. And once you provide that, you will have to deploy the application again, which is available under this button here, and you will clear build cache and deploy. So with that, you will have a persistent disk and it will not delete your flows. So once you are through the deployment steps, you will see a screen like this, and it will mention that your deployment is live. You can go to your account, and as you have previously ran any of the flows, you can open a new flow and run it, and it will start showing logs in your LangSmith dashboard. Now, if you had deployed Flowise on render using the Docker option as runtime, there is one additional step. You will have to go back to your repo where you had forked it, and in here you will go to the Docker folder, and in here you will create a new file, which is .env. There is an example available here. You can pretty much copy all of this and then create a new environment file and then add those variables. And once you add it here, the main section here is the LangChain based keys and values. So I am going to replace this with the values that we had. So we can head back to our dashboard in LangSmith and bring the content over and paste it right here. And just make sure to remove export. That is for running from the shell or terminal. And we will keep all of the values here. And same thing, we will also provide the API key. With that, we can save this, so we can commit changes directly, and that will save the environment.env file. And then there is an additional step of adding those keys and values to the YAML file as well. Now in here, I have added the variables. So in here, I am taking all of these variables that we had provided, and I am going to bring that over here, paste it here, and then also assign the values on the right side of equal sign. So once you do this, you can pretty much commit changes. And then with that, you can head back to your dashboard. And once you connect Flowise, and then you provide all of the info. Now, the next steps of adding the environment variables are already taken care of for you, so you don't have to do anything else, and you can go ahead and deploy the application. Now, if you had used Railway for your deployment of Flowise or LangFlow, then you will basically click on the link provided. This is for Flowise. I had previously provided similar for LangFlow, where once you click the link, it will bring you to this dashboard. And then in here, you basically can deploy the app. And once you hit deploy, it will ask you to create a repo, so you can keep it private or public. Since I had this name used before, I will change this. And now I can deploy. And once I hit deploy, it is going to go through the steps of deployment, and it will give us option to add the environment variables. Now in here, I can do same thing where I can add all of the environment variables as we have seen before. Okay, with that, I have provided the environment variables and I have also added the API key. And once I update variables, with that, it will redeploy. And once this redeploys, now you will have access to the runs that you will do in Flowise or LangFlow in your LangSmith dashboard. Now, just to show you an example of how you can use this, let's say if I have an agent application and I provided two different tools, and in here I am asking a question to browse the internet, and I want to make sure that it did the right thing to browse the internet. I can go back in my agent application, and for the question that I asked, I can see what steps exactly it took, and now I can see that it used the web browser tool and it gave me the response. So I know that the steps taken by the agent was in the right direction. Hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know how you are using LangSmith and what features you enjoy the most.